We shall now turn to examine in detail the building blocks of conceptual models and the process of building conceptual models.
We'll start with entities. Entities represent items which exist or can be thought of independently. Entities of at this level we saw before are Lekythos number 1055, Theophanti, Dipylon. Now the kinds or categories of entities are called classes, as we said, and these can be thought of as sets of similar entities, similar by some criterion. So we have the classes of Lekythos, figure, and place. Individual entities are called instances of the respective classes, and there is a need to identify uniquely the entities, be they classes or instances. So entities and classes of entities must have unique identifiers. The unique identifiers are usually automatically generated by the system that is managing the information, and we don't really need to worry about them. But for human readability and communication purposes, we also introduce unique names, real-world names given by us, purely for communication purposes. Now let's turn to relations and attributes. A relation is a set of associations of the same kind between pairs of individual entities. So, for instance, Lekythos found at place is a relation, and it is a set that comprises pairs, the first member of the pair being a Lekythos, the second being a place, and the meaning is that the Lekythos, which is the first element of the pair, was found at the place, that is the second element of the pair, of the pair, and we can have a listing of Lekythos found at places. This listing is the set of these pairs, and it is called a relation. These associations, these pairs, are called instances of the relation. So we have a relation as a set of associations and specific associations that are instances of that relation. On the other hand, an attribute is a private property of the entities of a given class, and this property takes a value from a specific set of values. So Lekythos weighs weight is a statement of a property of Lekythos, and once we consider any specific Lekythos, we can record the value of its weight, say 1.5 kilo. So when we consider particular entities and the value that they have for a particular attribute, we talk of attribute instances. We say that the attribute is instantiated and we have the instance of the attribute. Now, syntactically, if you think about it for a moment, syntactically, relations and attributes are similar. So you just have to think of values as special kind of entities and the analogy is complete. Having said that, relations and attributes can be treated in the same manner, and in fact, this is what happens with the treatment of relations and attributes in languages such as RDF that is used in for the semantic web. And in fact, in that language, relations and attributes together are called properties. So here, we will use the term property to refer collectively to relations and attributes, because we will deal with them in the same way. In both cases, relations and attributes, so for properties, there are two important sets that we talk about, the domain of the property and the range of the property. The domain of a property is the class of the first members of the pairs that belong to that property. And the range of a property is the class of the second members of the pairs. So Lekythos is the first, is the domain of the property found at. Place is the range of the property found at. Lekythos is the domain of the property, denoting attribute weighs, and weight is the range of the attribute weighs, and so forth. So consider the relation found near, an object found near some place. Here we show a set of pairs of objects found near some place. So what you see in this picture is a set of objects, a set of places, a set of object-place pairs, the meaning of the pairs being that the object was found near a place. In this picture, we have again a set of objects and a set of colors. And now the pairing means that the object has a certain color on it, is painted by a certain color. And in fact, an object may be painted with one color or with more colors. Now, in this case, this set of pairs denotes an attribute, the attribute painted in, object painted in color. It is quite clear, what I said before, that relations and attributes can be captured in practically the same way, so we can treat them syntactically in the same way. So if we put the attribute painted in and the relation found at in the same picture, here we come with properties, and in this picture we have two properties. One is a relation found near, the other is an attribute painted in, that have the same domain, object, and the same range, and the range place for the case of relation, and the range color for the case of attributes. Note that not every object needs to be known where it was found at, and we don't need to know what the color of every object is. Also, there may be colors in the list of colors that are not used in the objects we have in our collection, and there are places in which no objects were found. These observations are in fact quite important when we want to describe completely the nature of the relations or the attributes. And we come up with some statements and or conditions that have to hold, which we call cardinality constraints. What are cardinality constraints? They are rules that tell us whether a given property can have more than one value, or it needs to have at least one value, and things like that. So to make it concrete, a property may be required to have a single value, in which case we say that it is a single-valued property. For example, the blood type that is mentioned on an identity card can only have one value if it is written at all. So when the property can be given at most one value for every instance of its domain, then we call it a single-valued property. And we declare this by using the appropriate cardinality constraint. If this rule does not hold, if this condition does not hold, then this means that the property may have more than one value, and in this case we call it a multivalued property. Now, from a different angle, if a property must be given at least one value for every instance of its domain, such as, for example, the name of a person on an identity card, we call it a necessary property. So in fact, you cannot have an identity card issued with a name missing. When it is not necessary, a property is called optional. And then it may be both single-valued and necessary. For example, the identity number of an identity card is both single-valued and necessary. And we can have similar requirements for the inverse of a property. So that is the property read the other way around. So if we say that an identity card has a field that is name, now the inverse would be to take a name and figure out on which identity cards this name is written on. So each valid identity number must correspond to exactly one issued identity card. This means that the inverse is also single-valued and necessary, and therefore identity cards are required to correspond one-to-one with identity numbers. Cardinality constraints are really an indispensable part of the schema if we want the schema to be a correct representation of a domain. To denote cardinality constraints, we will use a specific notation, which is shown on this figure. suppose there is a class A related through property P with a class B. On either end of the arrow representing the property, we may use two numbers separated by two dots. Say the numbers MB and B are close to B, and the numbers MA and A are close to A. So the meaning of the number MB is that it is the least number of instances of B that an instance of A must be related with through the property P. So in the example below, if you consider ID card related property blood type, range blood type, having 0 as in the place of MB for blood type means that an instance of identity card must be related with at least 0 blood types. This means that the blood type property is optional. It is not necessary to relate it with one. But if the value is 1, this means that for every item in the set identity card, the field must be completed. So if you take the attribute, if you take name, for instance, identity card name string, then you see that we have an 1 there, meaning that there has to be at least one name on each identity card. Now, the second number, NB, is the greatest number of instances of B that an instance of A can be related with through the property P. In the case of blood type, this value is 1, because if this field is completed, then we are only allowed to write down one blood type for the person that the identity card is the holder of. Whereas in the case of name, we can write 1, 2 or more names. So if the number is indeterminate, there is no upper bound, it could be any number, we denote this with a star. Now, at the other end of the arrow, the MA and the NA have similar meanings. So the MA means the least number of instances of A that an instance of B must be related through P. And NA means the greatest number of instances of A that an instance of B can be related with through P. In the example, for the blood type property, it is a 0 dot dot star, which means that a given blood type need not be present on an identity card. So we may have issued thousands of identity cards, but still a blood type is not mentioned on any one of them. Or it may be present many times, so it is a 0 dot star star. Likewise, name, it is a 0 dot dot star, because any given name may not appear on any one of the issued identity cards, or it may appear many times. And in the case of has number, identity card has number, we see that it is a 1 to 1, 1 dot dot 1 on either side of the arrow, which means, as we said before, that identity cards and identity numbers are in a 1 to 1 correspondence.